Now, the worst aspect of arrogance, the very worst quality that is in arrogance, is that those who display arrogance are completely deprived of the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran that He will asrifu an ayati. I will divert my signs. أصرف آياتي عن الذين يتكبرون في الأرض بغير الحق. Those who are arrogant without any right to be arrogant. وإن يروا كل آية لا يؤمنوا بها. If they see every sign, they won't believe in it. وإن يروا سبيل الرشد لا يتخذوه سبيلا. If they see the clear path, if they see guidance, they won't take that path. وإن يروا سبيل الغي يتخذوه سبيلا. And if they see the path that deviates from the truth, that takes people away, they will take it as a path. Why? ذَلِكَ بِأَنُّهُمْ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا وَكَانُوا عَنْهَا غَافِلِينَ. That is because they denied our signs. They denied our signs out of arrogance. They denied our signs and they were heedless. غَفْلَة. And this is why Imam al-Junayd, the great, they call him Imam al-Ta'ifatayn, because he was a great faqih, but he was also a great spiritual master. Imam al-Junayd said, before learning about God, you have to empty your heart of arrogance. In traditional, when you study traditional science, they say, أَهَمُّهَا عَقَائِدٌ ثُمَّ فُرُوعٌ. The most important thing is learning aqidah, and then you learn fiqh. I learned, you know, أول واجب من عدم كل فهم مكن من نذر أن يعرف الله والرسول بالصفات مما عليه نصب الآيات. The first obligation is to learn Allah and His Messenger. This is what they teach. If you go any traditional madrasa training, first thing you learn aqidah, because that's أول واجب. Imam al-Junayd said the first thing that you should teach somebody is what the signs of arrogance are, and teach them how to fight those signs in themselves. Because if they're not doing that actively, it's a waste of time to teach them anything else, because even if they learn the information, they won't have the knowledge. They won't have the knowledge. Arrogance is a disease. The Prophet ﷺ said once, he said, لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةِ مَنْ كَانَ فِي قَلْبِهِ مِثْقَالُ ذَرَّةٍ مِنْ كِبْرٍ. No one will enter paradise if they have an atom's weight of arrogance in their heart. One atom's weight will prevent you from entering into paradise. One atom's weight. They forget that the Sahaba were all converts. The Sahaba were all converts. They converted to Islam. They weren't born in Islam. They were born in Jahiliyyah. But the Prophet ﷺ had the patience, the love, the care, the concern, and the forbearance to put up with all their arrogance, with all their jahiliyyah for 23 years until the entire Arabian Peninsula was in a state of Islam. وَلَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ إِسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. You have in the Messenger of Allah the best example. People won't put up for a person out here for 5 minutes talking about Islam. The Prophet put up with Abu Sufyan for almost 20 years fighting him, but still calling him to Islam until he finally became Muslim. And when he entered into Mecca, even though Abu Sufyan had fought him all those years, he honored Abu Sufyan. مَنْ دَخَلَ بَيْتَ أَبُو سُفْيَانَ كَانَ آمِنًا. Whoever enters into the house of Abu Sufyan is in a state of security. SubhanAllah. Because the Prophet didn't have this arrogance in his heart. The Prophet ﷺ said that you will see, he said, سِنْفَانِ مِنْ أَهْلَ النَّارِ لَمْ مِنْ أُمَّتِهِ. From my ummah, سِنْفَانِ مِنْ أَهْلَ النَّارِ لَمْ أَرَاهُمَا. I haven't seen them. And then he said, the first one, he said, رِجَالٌ لَهُمْ أَشْيَاطٌ كَأَذْنَابِ الْإِبَلِ كَأَذْنَابِ الْبَقَرِ يَضْرِبُونَ النَّاسِ. They would have these أَذْنَاب, like the tails of donkeys, of cows, which are the whips that these disgusting, despicable soldiers of these tyrants in the Muslim countries, and you see them carrying their sticks. And this is the interpretation that Sheikh Muhammad Amin al-Shinqiti gave.
that these are the police that do the orders of the tyrants, and they go and they beat the people. And this is happening in all of the prisons and the jails in the Muslim countries right now. People that pray and fast, young men and women that pray and fast, are being beaten by these despicable, less than human beings. And they're from, those people are for the fire, and they have no excuse before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to say that we're just doing what we were told. Even the kuffar reject that as a proof. And you look at the Nuremberg trials when they condemn those people who said, we were just following orders. No, you have a conscience. You've been given a damir by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you have to reflect on that fact. You have to reflect on that. Because Allah says that Fir'aun wa Haman wa junuduhuma. Fir'aun and Haman and his armies, all of them are in the wrong. You can't just say, oh, I was just following orders. That's not an excuse with Allah. لا طاعة لمخلوقٍ في معصية الخالق. There is no following the created one if you, it means disobeying the creator. And this is what the Islam came to take us out of, this ibadah, this ubudiyah lil-makhluqeen, the worship of created things. This is the pre-Islamic disease of the Persians and the Romans. The Arabs, interestingly enough, did not worship their leaders. This is something they learned from the Persians and the Romans. Following the ajam. لَتَتَّبِعَنَّ سُنَنَ الَّذِينَ سَنَنَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ شِبْرًا بِشِبْرًا ذِرَاعًا بِذِرَاعًا حَتَّى لَوْ دَخَلَ جُحَرَ طَبٍ لَدَخَلْتُمُوهُ. That you will follow the other peoples. And the interesting thing, now they've left the worship of divine kings. See, these Europeans have left all that. The worship of their rulers. I mean, they throw them out of office. But the Muslims now, everywhere you look, there's statues and pictures of these tyrants. And the Muslim, they put their picture out of fear in their hawanit of the thing. You go to Syria and somebody who doesn't have the picture of this khain in that place, he doesn't have the picture, and somebody going, what's the matter? Don't you like the Hafiz Sayyid al-Ustaz Hafiz al-Asad? Don't you like him? Something wrong with you? Where's the picture? Like it's a ubudiyah. And he's too afraid to say, لا يدخل الملائكة بيت فيه كلب أو صورة وهذا صورة الكلب. The angel doesn't come in a house where there's a picture and a dog. So what about a picture of a dog? They're too afraid to say that. And really, from one sense, we can't blame them. You know, wallahi, I mean, we should have pity. الشفقة على أمة محمدٍ sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We should have pity for these people, and many of them have suffered because of their just not even speaking out, just not conforming, just not going along with it. So I'm not in any way making fun of those people. Really, we should have shafaqah and rahmah for those people. It's a wretched condition to be in, but this is our state. Now, the next thing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, that you will see the barefoot, the ala, the barefooted, destitute, ri'asha yatatawaluna fil bunyan. You will see the barefoot, destitute, the shepherds, they will vie with one another in building exalted buildings. Now, this again can be taken at many levels. One of the ideas of bunyan in the Quran is the ideology. In other words, the bunyan of conceptualized constructs of thought. And these people vie in one another in trying to create better ways of ruling their societies and things like this. They have theorists who write whole books on what civilization should be and how people, what rules they should adhere to, without any looking at the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or even their own traditions. But the obvious meaning is quite clearly the Bedouin of the Arabian Peninsula, who literally 40 years ago were barefoot, destitute, and naked. Some of them during World War, during the Great Depression, had to make clothes, and I've heard this from people who lived during that time, had to make clothes from the palm leaves. From the palm leaves to cover their nakedness because it was so difficult to get cotton during that time. These people, and the Bedouin, traditionally you would see the people were almost half naked out there, because they had so little. And you will see them buying in building large buildings. Within our own lifetime, we've seen that. And I was in Dubai, going in a taxi, and I saw an old building and a larger building next to it. And on the old building, there was new construction going on. And I said to the man, what are they doing there? And he said, Sheikh so-and-so built the first, the old one, and that was the biggest building in the whole area. And then another Sheikh came, and he wanted to outdo him. So he built the second one, and then Sheikh so-and-so got mad. So he's building another series of stories in order to compete with so-and-so. And this man was a Bedouin, and I said to him, the hadith, he didn't even know what it meant. And I told him, do you know this hadith? And then I explained him the meaning, and he just said, Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Because he knew that he saw the ayah, but he didn't have the source to take it back to. So I was witnessing something the Sahaba believed in with Iman, and I was seeing it with my own eyes. A sign that the Prophet ﷺ would happen towards the end of time, which is extraordinary. Now another thing, يَتَطَوَلُونَ فِي الْبُنْيَانِ means, according to Raghib al-Isbahani, also to build by degrees and then break down and rebuild again. Now this is something unique to the 20th century. You will see whole buildings destroyed and flattened in order to build a new, bigger and larger building. So it can also have that meaning, which is happening all over in these cities, where they build a perfectly good building just to build. And that's, it's israf, it's hadam, it's israf, it's absolute profligacy. And yet it happens. And we're witnessing it in our own time. So the Prophet ﷺ gave us these signs.